Welcome back to Game Theory, a smarter way to play and deeper look at the issues and individuals that define the video game business. I'm Scott Steinberg, and as our last episode clearly revealed, this is an industry under siege. Still, no pressure, no diamonds, right? But what I do find troubling is the fact that as the economy rebounds, so many seem content to write recent troubles off as a one-time glitch. My suspicion? That we've actually undergone a tectonic shift as a business, as today's audience hasn't just changed. It's also splintered into countless sub-niches, each of which need to be served in increasingly more diverse and demanding methods. Which makes me wonder, have we really learned our lesson yet?
Overall, the industry is on the same general path. We are still today in a world of retail, where people are going to retail stores, they're standing outside before a new product launches. That's the way it will be for the sort of short term. Long term, this industry is going digital, and it's going digital very quickly. To some extent, as the retailers come up with policies like used games, they're actually putting their foot on the gas pedal to oblivion. And that ultimately is going to make the game industry digital about as fast as it can possibly be.
The change is happening depending on who you're talking about. For hardcore gamers, very little change. They want high quality, big budget games, and they're willing to pay for it. For the casual market, they're a lot more fickle, and they're a lot more sensitive to what happens in the economy. If you're catering to that market, it's gonna be a roller coaster ride. And this is why we're seeing a lot of game companies hunkering down with, you know, high quality AAA games. You know, that's a pretty steady audience.
For much of the history of the industry, it was a winner-take-all, single-platform model. Clearly, it's never going to be that way again. I think in the future, any kind of game company, they have to have a technology approach that gives them agility across platform boundaries. That's going to play into where gaming really needs to go, which is to become like SaaS, or software as a service, where customers are going to the cloud and they have an account and they have virtual items and can play, but they may come in from a variety of different devices. It's going to be really about simplicity and convenience and making that model work.
The startups now that you're seeing, these guys are doing casual games and they're putting them either on Facebook or on an iPhone. Those are really easy platforms to get on. I mean, they're low barriers to entry to create that stuff, and they're quite nimble. I think what shocked everybody is how popular those two avenues are.
In the old days, when you had complete reliance on brick and mortar distribution, it was easier for the companies that had a lot of financial muscle to dominate physical distribution. It was really more of a brand-driven industry, and of course a lot of the video games that did well were sequels. Now you've got all these free games. There are free games on the web, there's free games on the iPhone, there's free games on Facebook, and it's a lot easier to get people to spread them virally, tell their friends about them. Brands aren't as important, so it's much more important now for game companies to be intellectual property companies and invent something meaningful and new.
That's really the pattern of the industry. You either move or you don't. It's a bit like the music industry. You're you two or you're not. And if you want to be there in the later branches of the tree, you better be able to evolve.
Easier said than done, though, as last I checked, Darwinism was a cruel mistress. But if anyone could successfully quarter, you would think it would be the world's top publishers. And yet, despite years of promises, returns continue to plummet, and rising revenue numbers seem to be the new net profits. But executives like Electronic Arts head John Riccitiello and Activision CEO Bobby Kotick are no fools. So why do their firms often take it on the chin?
When times get harder or big changes happen, the bigger, more established companies are the ones that have the harder time turning the ship, right? You got a big boat, you can't do a 360. Are we as agile as we need to be? Because fundamentally, even John Riccitiello is a game developer, whether he thinks of himself as that or not, and he needs to be as agile and as dynamic and as responsive to the reality of his consumers as any designer does. It's a hard thing. I mean, the game system of EA is about 1,000 orders of magnitude more complicated than the game system of Skate.
We have to change. And I think what will happen in the next few years is that we will make those changes. We will become profitable again, and there will be yet another heyday. The stimulus for that change will again be a distribution change in going digital, so we don't have to put a box on a truck, don't have to pay 20% to the store for holding it, don't have to do a lot of resale of that game, rental, all these other things. Much clearer business model to the developer. And I also think alternate business models that are good for the gamer, good also for the publisher.
There's a fear at retail that, you know, the shift to online is now, and I don't think that's true at all. I mean, we're going to get more and more and more stuff online, but not full game downloads, because you have to train the consumer that the way he's going to enjoy games in the future is he's not going to have a disc. He can't take it to his friend's house to play. He's going to have some, you know, account in the cloud, and I don't think people are really comfortable with that yet.
I think we're actually in the Cambrian explosion of games, where all these weird new life forms are popping out for the very first time and filling these niches that are appearing dramatically. And of course, a lot of the old established things are going to be dying off pretty rapidly, even the major life forms. But more than anything else, I see this as probably the healthiest thing that could possibly happen in the industry.
In other words, it's time to evolve or die. But that's a tricky balancing act. Today's top firms don't just have to develop across a range of platforms, price points, and different audiences. They also have to source feedback from fans and iterate games in real time. All of which means a modern game's lifecycle often starts, not finishes, at what's in the box, making it more service than product. So how can today's studios adapt?
Cut your costs. Cut your costs and cut them. Don't just cut them. Cut them right down to the bone. And keep them there. Overhead, luxuries, anything at all. Your development process, right down to nothing. You got to have the smartest people. You've got to do make the most clever decisions. This is where the clever people win.
So much freemium being offered to the audience. It's harming a lot of the deeper quality experiences that are finding fewer places to get an outlet. That are the traditional box product model. But at the same time, it's opening up a new way of thinking. And I think the most important thing that's being revealed in the social network space is that it's recruiting tens of millions of new users annually that are becoming gamers. Now they're becoming veteran gamers. And we didn't have them before because they never would have bought a PlayStation, they never would have bought an Xbox, and they probably never would have signed up for Steam. Therein lies the question, how are the nets being thrown to capture? And it's a serious, radical shakeup time.
People don't understand that we're not really seeing a migration from packaged goods at the consumer level to social mobile games. We're seeing an expansion of gaming in addition to the packaged products onto those platforms. I don't actually think it's the same people. I don't think that the Halo player is suddenly playing Farmville. I don't think this is a threat to packaged products at all. And I think what we should see, which is not what we're seeing, is the publishers envious of how successful guys like Zynga, Playfish, Playdom are, and try to emulate them. Instead, you see a panic that they're jealous of how successful these guys are, and they decide they have to buy them.
Personally, as a designer, you know, I have to really question some of the things that I built the foundation of my thinking on. It's scary to have your sort of underlying philosophies being pulled and twisted and contorted. But again, it's exciting. The minute you start saying, no, that's wrong, we have to protect the way games are, 30 seconds before you even say it, you're toast.
Agreed. Change is good, especially for an industry barely in its adolescence. But just how healthy is the situation? And what becomes of us from having gone through these growing pains? As a prelude to our upcoming discussion on risk versus reward, we ask the experts to weigh in.
Do I think it's the end of the industry? No. Is everything fine? No, it's not fine. If it were fine, we wouldn't see losses at big publishers. We wouldn't see that size layoff at Activision or at an EA.
If you want to sort of crystal ball for the future, you can just see that idea of free, that idea of easy access to games, these kind of things are going to be very valuable.
And that's the key takeaway. We're moving towards a better system, a better model, a lower cost model, where the players that are in the new game are the people who are contributing and not just taking dollars out. I don't know how long it's going to last, but I know when it finishes changing, the digital distribution, the microtransaction, the DLC stuff, the shrinking at retail, closer to your customer. Every one of those things are going to be true, and we'll have a better industry.
Still, as we at Game Theory remind you, the answers are never simple. As this week's homework assignment, we invite you to consider the following questions. And be sure to hit us up at our website, GameTheoryOnline.com, with your thoughts. Until next time, this is your professor, Scott Steinberg, signing off.